Morning. I'd like to welcome everyone to Grace United Methodist Church. This little brisk Sunday, second Sunday of Lent. Glad to see you all. Great to be here. I hopefully didn't do what I did and overslept because of the time change. So I was guilty. Guilty as charged. But I'd like to highlight a few announcements today. First, I don't know if we have any visitors with us. I'd like to introduce themselves, or you can well say welcome to Warren. He's here. This is your show. Check out here. It's good to have you here. And any other visitors who we have. We do have tons of things coming up in the spring, which you can read in our upcoming event list here in the bulletin. Lots and lots of things, but I'll just highlight just a few that are coming up soon. Today, some folks may be going to the follow-up workshop, the Reaching New People tune-up. I imagine Pastor Darlene will be talking a little bit about that. That's this afternoon. And then next Saturday is the District North Coast District Leadership Academy, and there's a little bulletin here, or a little flyer in your bulletin about that for your church. And then, of course, the famous pancake breakfast will be next Sunday. So hopefully everyone will come for that. But other than that, you can kind of read through and see what is coming of interest, including the Easter party and the rummage sale. At this point, I'd like to ask everyone to stand and pass the peace of Christ to those around.
Oh, there we go.
I haven't had any of those.
You can't eat any of those.
Thank you.
please invite everyone to join me in the call to worship. Come, all who need help.
Our help comes from God, the one who made the heaven and earth.
Come, all who desire blessing.
Our blessings come from God, the God of Abraham, the God of the ages.
Come, all who long for salvation.
Our salvation comes from Jesus Christ, the one sent by God to save the world.
Asking for your blessing on
this journey to the cross.
The abundance of your love is already around us. Open our eyes to see the blessings of your creation and the beauty all around us. And our ears to hear the blessing of our word as it is proclaimed in story and song. Open our hearts to experience the blessings of faith
through the gentle touch of a friend
or the supportive smile of a stranger. And open our doors that we may become vessels of your blessing to a world still in need of salvation.
In our midst this day,
come Holy Spirit, you are welcome here. All this we pray in the name of Jesus Christ.
Amen. I'd like to invite the ushers to come forward for Hannah's offerings and prayer requests.
Spirit, hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah.
Thank you for the abundant grace that you freely give. Let our church be a community that lives by this good news. Even our faith in Jesus Christ is a gift we receive. Use these offerings to further our church's mission, providing opportunities for people to grow in wisdom and to spread the harmony of your peace. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. If I have told you about earthly things and you do not believe, how can you believe if I tell you about heavenly things? No one has ascended into heaven except the one who descended from heaven, the Son of Man. And just as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, so must the Son of Man be lifted up, that whoever believes in him may have eternal life. For God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, so that everyone who believes in him may not perish, but have eternal life. Indeed, God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but in order that the world might be saved through him. This is the word of the Lord.
Easter Sunday.
All right, very good. Easter Sunday. Here we come, one more.
So you all can count down the days when you take these home and find out, how long it is before Easter. Okay. And then this is for any of the bigger kids who may not want the children's money. Okay? So we'll make sure you get those before you leave. All right. Now I just want to talk to you also briefly about a message that we're going to talk to our bigger people about. And it's a story in our Bible. Okay? Let me see if anyone knows what this is first. Anyone know what this is? Okay, I saw your hand.
A butterfly.
Butterfly. So I'm going to tell you in a minute while I'm talking about the butterfly, okay? Alright, let's put these glasses on, okay? Alright. One night, there was a man named Nicodemus who came to talk to Jesus. And as Jesus was talking to him, he said something that Nicodemus didn't understand. He told Nicodemus, "No one can see the kingdom of God unless he is born again." Nicodemus was really puzzled by what Jesus said. He just couldn't understand how someone could be born again. And to this day, a lot of people still have trouble understanding how that can be possible. Does anyone here have an idea how it is that we can be born again if you were already born once? Yes.
You go to bed.
You go to bed? Well, in a sense, very good. Good answer. Anyone else? No? Okay, anyone else? Okay, all right, well I'm going to kind of give you an example because it is kind of hard to understand. And that's why we're talking about our butterfly. So let me see, does anyone know how a butterfly becomes a butterfly? Okay, I saw your hand.
First it's a caterpillar and then it goes to like a cycle where it eats a lot and then goes into the cocoon. After a few months it turns into a butterfly.
Okay, what are you going to say?
I was going to say it goes through metamorphosis.
No.
Did I say the word for
you? Yeah. Very good. Sure, very good. Very smart. Anyone else know how a butterfly becomes a butterfly? Yes.
It flies.
Yes, it does. Very good. Amen. It flies after it becomes a butterfly. Okay, well, let me read to you this so you all get excellent answers, okay? It says, as you probably know, the butterfly started out as a fuzzy little caterpillar. Now, some people may think caterpillars are cute, some may think that they are funny, but probably no one will say that they are necessarily as beautiful as the butterfly, okay? And this particular writer says that a caterpillar is really just a worm with hair on it. What do you think about that? Yes. Okay, you think about it and let me know. All right. Okay. A caterpillar is really a worm, and worms, in this particular writer's words, are not beautiful. Then one day the caterpillar spins a cocoon about himself and stays there for several weeks, like what we're talking about. And when it comes out, it is no longer a caterpillar. It has been miraculously changed into a beautiful butterfly. Okay? So God didn't just take a caterpillar and stick some wings on them and him or her, or and paint the wings all different colors. When the cocoon opens and the butterfly crawls out, it's a new creation and the caterpillar is gone. It has now become a what? A butterfly, that's right. Okay, so that is a good picture of what Jesus meant when he said that we could be born again. The Bible says that if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. The old has gone and the new has come. So when we invite Jesus to come into our hearts, we become a new creation. Can you all say new creation? Can you say new creation? Okay, new creation. God doesn't just clean us up and slap a little paint on us, but he makes us into a new person. Now, let me ask you a question. Would you rather be a hairy worm or would you rather be a butterfly? Butterfly.
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 Butterfly. Bird. Okay. All right. Oh boy, that's what I had to say. All right. Okay. So with this, bow your hands and repeat after me. Dear Lord, we thank you for sending Jesus to die on the cross so that we, like the butterfly, can become a new creation. We ask you to change us and to make us beautiful. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. All right, we turn and
I know you do.
Every single child. Dos sisters. Let's give her a hand. Once again, another Lenten hymn. Were you there? Let us pray. Loving Lord, we come before you and we do want to thank you for this day and for allowing us to gather. We want to thank you, O God, for your word, which we are about to hear from. And so in that manner, we always pray that Garmy will sit down and you will stand up and share with us what it is that you have for us on this day. Also pray that you would bind the enemy so that he will not steal your word from our hearts, as well as letting the words of my mouth and the meditations of my heart be acceptable in your sight. O Lord, you who are our strength and our redeemer. In Jesus' name we do pray and ask all these things. Amen. Amen. You have heard the reading of our scripture from the Gospel of St. John, the third chapter, verses 1 through 17. And of course, this is a passage where that very, very familiar John 3:16 is found, for God so loved the world, as you heard in the reading. And so we do have a title for you today as we continue with our theme for Lent, which is looking for love in all the wrong places. And last week we talked about temptation, and this week we're talking about looking for the help. Looking for the help. And I think, Rob, you told me the name of the gentleman who sings this song. I don't know if you remember that. He's a country singer, I think he was. Okay. Well, I can't remember, but those of you who remember that song, that's not what it's based upon, but at least the title is kind of catchy, but we got it from him. Looking for love in all the wrong places, looking for the helper.
Johnny Lee.
Johnny Ray?
Lee.
Lee.
Johnny Lee. Okay. All right. So thank you, Johnny Lee, for this title. So as I like to do, today we'll do a little bit more teaching than we normally do, but just want to help you get an understanding of this passage. In one commentary, it states that there's a dialogue here with Jesus and Nicodemus, and this particular dialogue, as one commentary reports, is only found in the Gospel of John, and he is not mentioned in the other, what we call synoptic, S-Y-N-O-P-T-I-C, synoptic Gospels, and of course that would be Matthew, Mark, and Luke, like I said, and John. And whereas some of those Gospels will find some of the same stories, maybe told a different way, from a different perspective, but this one is where we find Nicodemus in the book of John. Now, Nicodemus is a Pharisee, and he comes to Jesus at night. So right away, that should alert us to two different things, okay? Nicodemus is a leader of the Jews, and we have found out as we read through our Gospels that the Pharisees are a powerful, authoritative religious group. And if you keep reading, you'll find out that they are always doing their best, whatever they can do, to get Jesus or to trip him up in some kind of way. It also mentions that Nicodemus came at night to see Jesus. And for those of you who have children, there are some people who have kind of nicknamed Nicodemus Nick at Night. That's for the ones who have children and grandchildren. Okay. Nickelodeon at night.
Keep that day job back.
Okay, okay. I know. All right. I tried. Anyway, so those are two things that should alert you already. That number one, he's a Pharisee, and he's also, as the Bible is specifically saying, he comes at night. And so the question you know, does he not want to be seen with Jesus? Is that why he came at night? You know, was he truly inquiring about Jesus and saying, wow, you know, this man, you are awesome, and I think I want to, you know, be a part of your group, but, you know, I can't come in the daytime, so he's coming at night. So was he truly inquiring? Or was he sent there by the Pharisees to kind of trip and to trap Jesus? And so once again, our inquiring minds want to know, and it's not 100% all the way stated as to why he was there, but those are some things that we kind of infer a little bit or question. And so we do find out that Nicodemus is trying to understand Jesus' comments, but Nicodemus is thinking in physical categories and not spiritual ones. Listen to the dialogue that was going on. And I suppose that many of us would have probably done the same in response to Jesus' words. Nicodemus kept asking, how can these things be? How can these things be? Now, the advantage that we may have over Nicodemus is that we have the New Testament, so we can read it. But you have to remember, once again, the only thing Nicodemus is going by is what was called the Hebrew Bible, or what we know as the Old Testament. So, you know, he's still going, you know, what's going on? And even though this reveals Nicodemus's paradoxical situation, despite his assertion of being in the know, because he was a learned man, Nicodemus really does not know the source of God's presence and, of course, his son Jesus. Because they're just trying to figure all this out. This man has come on the scene, and he's talking stuff about being God and doing all these miracles, and, you know, they're a little confused. Nicodemus is a teacher of Israel, and he is just simply not understanding these things, as we find in verse 10. And the other thing is, he can think only in a fixed, literal, and limited term at this moment. He is, as Jesus has said, born of the flesh. And so that's the way Nicodemus is thinking, because right at this particular point in time, that's all that he is knowing. And the thing is, I don't want to be too critical of Nicodemus, like I had mentioned before, because I think if Jesus was saying some of those things to us, and not knowing that he's the Son of God like we know now, you know, we might be kind of questioning him too, like, this guy, I'm going to talk to him about something else, and he's gone completely left field on me. I don't even know what you're talking about. How can these things be? You know, and we could be thinking the same way as Nicodemus because we do have brains, amen, right? And we also have free will, you know, God did not make us puppets. And so we can think critically, we can think concretely, and even sometimes abstractly, you know, and we do our best to try to figure out things by analyzing them and in the natural, you know. And that's the same way that Nicodemus was coming to Jesus. And the thing is, Jesus knows that, and because he knows that, that is why he was telling Nicodemus, and of course, consequently us, through his word, so many of us do the same thing. We get caught up in the tangible, the natural. And we also get caught up in the, well, you know, if I can't see it, I can't believe it, flesh and blood world. So once again, Jesus is saying to Nicodemus that there is more to life than the flesh or the natural way of thinking, and that there is also the spiritual, and for our conversation today, and precisely the Holy Spirit, okay? And we want to make sure that we're reaching the Holy Spirit, because there is a spiritual world, as Jesus is saying, and we want to rely upon the Holy Spirit, but there are also some other spirits out here floating around that are quite ungodly and not of the Lord. So we are precisely talking about the Holy Spirit. But the Holy Spirit, if you're not familiar with the Holy Spirit in your life, operates like the wind, as Jesus is saying, which we cannot see, but what we can see and hear and feel are the effects or the things that happen to things, especially as we, you know, had our little windstorm basically last week. There was a lot of trees falling down, and of course, and if you watch any news, you may have seen a little girl, anybody in Florida, a little girl who gets out of her mom's car, they're coming from wherever, and she has a cell phone in one hand, and she grabs the handle of the door on the other hand, and at that holding on for dear life, and the door flings her, and the wind flings the door as well as her, you know, up against the house. She's okay. Mom came running to make sure. But so we did not see the wind, and we didn't necessarily hear, but I know I did hear the wind going, you know, outside of my house. So we can see the effects, and we can hear it, and also, you know, we can feel it. So this is what Jesus is saying about the Holy Spirit, to kind of give us an idea or illustration if some of us are having a hard time kind of contemplating or thinking about, okay, how is this Holy Spirit, you know, making itself known? Well, that's kind of sort of the illustration that Jesus uses. And well, once again, we may not be able to see the Holy Spirit as such, but we can, especially if we are in Christ, we can definitely see and hear and feel Him moving, or see the effects of Him moving in our lives and, of course, in our world. Because our bodies are more than just our flesh and blood. The Holy Spirit is real, and He can work in our bodies if we let Him. And this is what Jesus is trying to get over to Nicodemus, okay? So Nick at night, get it, Nick? Okay, I cracked my own stuff up, it's all right. So Nick is looking through the eyes of his own understanding. He's looking through the tangible, the literal, from what his mind can conceive, and from only what his brain is thinking. Los Altos United Methodist Church has a statement that says, oftentimes we believe that we must deserve the love that we receive. We work to get an approval and to feel like our life is justified because we have pulled our own weight, thinking that whatever life we create and love we get is only that we ourselves have been able to make it up without any help from anything, anybody. And Jesus is saying, okay, yeah, all right, that's cool and it's not cool. Because Jesus is saying to him, but there is more. There is the Holy Spirit. There is the Helper. So John 3, verses 1 through 17 offers the image of God as our keeper, always helping and always present. We thank God for allowing Him to give us brains where we can do some things in our physical ability so that we can take care of some things. But He is saying, even in the midst of all that, there is the spiritual that you need to focus on as well. So Nicodemus has probably been, like many of us, following all the rules, doing everything, you know, that you can do that's right. And yet, some of us can still look for love or look for help in all the wrong places. And one of those wrong places would be looking only for a tangible connection with God, something that you can see. I mean, that's why we have people do different objects and different things like that they worship, because they need that as opposed to the Holy Spirit. But once again, Jesus says that he must be born of the Spirit, and it's not up to you to create your own salvation and being good, and I've been this, and I'm all that. But the thing is, Jesus is saying, you still need me. You still need the Spirit in your life. It's not simply doing the right thing, but it's about allowing the Spirit to help birth love into our lives and having faith that the Spirit of God is always present and urging us to choose love. And of course, we know the scripture, for God so loved the world. So neither Nicodemus nor anyone else is born of the Spirit and has eternal life until the following certainty is embraced. And we learn that from our word today. Once again, for God so loved the world, that he gave his only Son, so that everyone who believes in him may not perish, but may have eternal life. So indeed, God did not send the Son into the world to condemn the world, but in order that the world might be saved through him. And of course, that's being born again, as I was sharing with the young people. So Jesus continues by saying that new life in the Spirit will come only at the cost of Jesus being lifted up, which is another point I wanted to make today, because this reference is to Moses' bronze serpent in the book of Numbers from the Old Testament. So like I said, only thing that Nicodemus has to go by is the Old Testament. So Jesus was letting him know, look, I know you know the word from the Old Testament, but I know it too. And he's trying to make that bridge. He's trying to make that correlation between what happened in the Old Testament and how it is basically confirmed now in the New Testament. So he's talking about, he calls to mind for Nicodemus this Old Testament image, and about how the Israelites who gazed upon this raised serpent that Moses would raise up, and how they would be saved from a deadly serpent's bite. And Jesus is saying that he needed to be lifted up, and not only will that save that will save humanity. So the crucified Jesus will now be that uplifted saving image, just like the serpent on the pole was for Moses, to save all of humanity. So looking for salvation or help in our own doings is not a good thing. So Jesus was making that correlation. Now, we can look for salvation or look for help in things and in people and in situations and circumstances that make us feel good. But unfortunately, unless you're just one of those rare people, a lot of us have found out that these are not the things that can necessarily help us, nor do they last extremely long. Things that make you feel good, whatever that could be, we are depending only on that, is what I'm saying, only on that, and only on these particular situations. You know, our homes, you know, sometimes floods come, and fire comes as we listen to the news, and our children, as much as we would love for them to just be our shining glory forever and ever and ever, you know, sometimes children do their own thing, in their own way, in their own time, all the above. Anybody know what I'm talking about? So you can't put your faith in your home necessarily, or in your children, or in that job, you know? Jobs nowadays are very different, and they're coming and they're going. Our bodies, you know, I think his name is I'm not sure, Ted Williams, somebody's frozen and doing cryogenics, and he's frozen his body so that whenever they find the technology, they can revive him and he can come back to life. Well, you know, unless Jesus intervenes, I'm not sure if that's going to exactly happen, but you know, if it does, it will definitely be a miracle. And so our vehicles, you know, things happen to us. How many accidents do we see? We can put our trust and our hope in our spouses, and we've got some good ones out there, but sometimes, you know, they leave, or sometimes they die. You know, our hair, those of you who have lost hair over the years, you know, I'm just saying, I'm not looking at anybody. Relationships, you know, we can put all our trust and all that in there, but, you know, those are not the things that are going to last. And that's what Nicodemus was doing. He was thinking in the natural. Everyone is looking for some type of salvation, for help. And true salvation, once again, can only be found in Jesus Christ. So as I prepare to close, let me say this. Nicodemus may also be like people who are so resistant to change that they keep claiming that new possibilities are still impossible. So Nicodemus is so puzzled by the unexpected nature of Jesus' images and the possibilities of his promises that all he can keep asking as you read through the scripture is, how is this possible? Well, how can this be? How is this possible? And the answer to the question, how is it possible, is that we've got an impossible God. Look to your neighbor and say, neighbor,
we've got
an impossible God.
Impossible God.
That's right. That is to say, we have a God who defies what is possible, who transforms a this is not possible unbelief into an obedient faith. Thank you, Jesus. So don't look for your help like Nicodemus was necessarily in things, but of course in Jesus Christ. And then I want to say this, and then I'm going to say something else after this too, which is going to be very interesting. But I want to mention some impossible statements that are made, and I want you to respond with, for God so loved the world, okay? So when I say, it's your time to respond, who are you going to respond and say what?
For God so loved the world.
Okay, listen to this impossible statement. I don't think I can face another day of working at my impossible job.
For God so loved the world.
I can't seem to get control of my impossible drinking, eating, and gambling addiction.
For God so loved the world.
I have impossible monthly bills that now outweigh my monthly income.
For God so loved the world.
I am facing an impossible situation with my children.
For God so loved the world.
problem in my life that I am finding it too impossible to face.
For God so loved the world.
Amen. So let's stop looking for love or help in all the wrong places and look into Jesus, who is the author and finisher of our faith. Now, I want to say this, and you can just take it for what it's worth, all right? Someone here had mentioned, and some of us have jokingly laughed at what we may see as the impossible, okay? But I think, looking through the eyes of Jesus and faith, that the possible can happen. Someone had mentioned that across the street, we now have an empty giant Eagle building, right? Everyone know that? Okay, and they hadn't even thought about calling it Christ Giant Eagle United Methodist Church. Now, I do hope that they do bring like a Dave's or Aldi's or something in there, but we'll see.
I still work there.
Yeah. Okay, well, not the one across the street, though, but we're glad you still work there. And well, you know, you can be our greeter if that ever happens. But here's the vision. Here's the vision. Why not, if we're able to get it, we call it Christ United Methodist Mission Center, okay? Last known as Giant Eagle, where when we have seen these things going to different workshops, but there is a free pharmacy for low-income people, a free medical clinic in there, and we would renovate it where there's a worship space that is handicapped accessible and lots of parking. We would have in there like a little fitness park where there's basketball, handball, and tennis courts, and even what we call a green gym facility, which means that while you're working out, you're producing energy to be able to do some things. Have a daily food pantry or co-op, and also a homeless shelter, especially for families. Also provide homeless mailboxes for people, because you can't get a job if you don't have an address, and you don't have an address if you don't have a home. So we provide homeless mailboxes for them, shower facilities for the homeless, daily free community meals, job creation using discarded tires and glass and wood. We could develop like an inner city shark tank, like the one that LeBron started here in Cleveland. A free store where people are able to come and get free clothing, and have empowerment classes where we are teaching people in our community about how to handle their finances, how to do crock pot cooking, infant mortality classes for pregnant moms, and also a computer center for job searching, and so much more. Let us pray. Let me know what comes before you. Thank you so much for your word. And we thank you for reminding us that the possible can come from impossible. And we thank you for reminding us that we are more than just flesh and blood. We are more than just brains analyzing. But we are spirit. And just like Nicodemus, you want us to be in tune with the Holy Spirit, which comes from you. And the Trinity, God the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. And of course, if there's anyone here in the sound of my voice, and you have never accepted Christ into your life as your personal Savior, then know that today is the day you need to get that done. And you can do that by saying this prayer. You don't have to say it out loud, but you can say it to yourself, something like this. Dear Jesus, I believe that you died on the cross, and that you rose again, and that you're coming back again. So now I confess that I've given you my life, take my life, leave my life, and when it comes time for me to die, for I surely will die one day, and or be caught up in the rapture, please take me home to heaven today with you. For it's in Jesus' name that I do pray and ask all these things. Amen. And of course, if you said that prayer, the angels in heaven are rejoicing, and I rejoice with you. And of course, if you're looking for Christian discipleship information, look for our bulletin. And membership, please feel free to call the office. Amen. We're going to speedily move on now to our time of prayer, our pastoral prayer. And we do have a few prayer cards for you here. Praying for public worship. The Streeter family, the Pick family. Fleet, let Fred. Sorry, I just can't read it, but we'll have it in our hearts. I'm also praying for James as he will heal. Thank you, everyone. God bless. And also prayers for the So with that, let us pray. Thank you so much. Our Heavenly Father, we do come before you. We're going to start off with silent prayer to give you a few seconds to bring your own personal joys and concerns to the Lord. And then we'll come in with our pastoral prayer, and then we'll conclude together with the Lord's Prayer. So with that, now, let us begin our time of prayer. Our Heavenly Father, we come before you. Thank you so much for the beauty of this day, even the coldness of this day. Because we're here and we're able to feel it, we thank you for reminding us that you want us to continue on and that you have more work for us to do. We come before you asking for forgiveness for all of our sins, thanking you for all of the joys in our lives, and also bringing to you all the concerns that are on our hearts. So Lord, like the lawyer Nicodemus, we come to you in hidden ways. We have lots of questions and concerns, and some of us aren't sure that you will even listen to them, or that you will think that our questions are foolish. New life sounds wonderful, and we have, some of us made messes in this life, some of which we have cleaned up, but there are others that we have swept under the rug, hidden away in the closet, hidden from ourselves, and we believe hidden from you. But you know us better than we want to be known. You know our thoughts and actions. Help us, Lord. How can we turn things around so that there is peace and hope? We offer to you concerns for family, community, and nation, and yet we don't really expect that anything will change. At least some of us don't. Some of us are unwilling to change ourselves, and so change for the world appears to be just a dream. And we pray that you help us to get out of that mindset and trust in you. Bring your presence powerfully to us and convince us of the hope that rests in you alone. And then, Lord, as we close out our prayer, we do want to remember all of our military, all the firefighters and police officers, and of course, all of us, oh God, that you watch over us and keep us as safe as possible. We thank you for growth and pray for more, spiritually, numerically, and financially, as well as sending us laborers for the harvest to carry out your work and your mission here for such a time as this. So we decree and declare that things are so according to your will, and we ask all these things in the precious and powerful name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Let every heart say, Amen. And then, O God, you've given us this wonderful prayer to pray, as in our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Come, thy will be done, as in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Five marks of love.org to to watch a video and answer the questions as part of your devotional activities for your day. And then on the back of it is a hand called the listening hand. And in the space below, you'll find a hand with five fingers, drawing from the list of names of people who are or have been channels of God's good news to you. Choose one name to write on the tip of each finger during the week, and then you can read the rest of it. And one reason why we're going to call this grab, gather, and grow, because you can do this by yourself, or you can grab your family, do it around the dining room or kitchen table or living room, or if you want to invite some friends over or go to a restaurant and look over this and read about it and then follow the activity. Because once again, this is our season of Lent, where we're trying to draw closer to God, and hopefully this hands-on activity will help you to be able to do it. Get it? Hands-on, hand, from the insert. Okay, I guess everybody's hungry, so I'm going to stop talking. Let's stand and sing Hymn of Dedication.